the Ka Ning Shedrib Ling Monastery. A stifling and gloomy place. Those who will be participating in this ceremony are young priests. They are still only children. And they will spend their lives in the monastery. Their days will be spent in hunger and poverty. They will not work, and they will beg for food. They will have no family lives, and they will have nothing to wear but these clothes. And what is more, they will do all this in the name of a superstitious belief, in order not to be reborn as a fly or a mouse. Because they believe in a religion that is full of superstition and error. Buddhism. Buddhism is such an enormous error that it regards people torturing themselves as a virtue. People cut themselves off from life in the name of myth and superstition. For Buddhists, who spend their days in pointless, irrational rituals, life is always dark and stagnant. Furthermore, amongst all these rituals, Buddhism causes people to forget God, or even to deny Him. Islam, on the other hand, totally opposes this distorted mentality. It offers people a rational, restorative, and dynamic life. Quite unlike Buddhists, those who live by the moral values of Islam are always productive, happy, and at peace. And most important of all, those who live by the moral values of Islam draw close to God, the Lord of all creation, and gain the greatest happiness possible for human beings, the good pleasure of God. This film portrays the religion of Buddhism and its irrational practices. Those who regard Buddhism as a road to peace and contentment as a result of deceptive propaganda should pay close attention to the truths described in this film. In the 6th century BC, India was under the occupation of the Aryans. The dominant religion in the country was that of the Aryans, Brahmanism. The Aryans implemented a strict caste system in the country. Under that caste system, society was divided into different groups. Brahmin priests were at the top of the system and ruthlessly oppressed the people. During those years, a son was born to Prince Suddhodana, a member of the noble Sakya family, Siddhartha Gautama. Siddhartha spent his youth in ease and plenty. When he reached the age of 29, however, he left the palace he was living in and turned to a mystical quest, as a result of which he set out certain principles. These principles gradually turned into a teaching, Buddhism. Buddhism arose in northeast India. In time, it extended throughout Sri Lanka, Burma, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, China, Tibet, Mongolia, Manchuria, Korea, and Nepal. Today, it has about 330 million followers. The word Buddha means the awakened or enlightened one, signifying the spiritual heights that Siddhartha Gautama is supposed to have attained. And Siddhartha is remembered by that name. Buddha chose to speak about his basic tenets and hand on his form of worship orally. The teachings of Buddha were handed on from generation to generation, in oral form only, for 400 years. This teaching was then collected in a book called Pali Canon. The text regarded as sacred by Buddhism today is the Tipitaka, which contains many crass errors. This text was written in the Pali language. Buddhist priests perform their ceremonies and organize their lives according to this text. The only subject matter in these books is people suppressing all their desires and trying to train their souls by living lives full of poverty and suffering. Buddhists have so concentrated on those matters that they are totally unaware of a far more important truth. That truth is the existence of God. Many people who lack a comprehensive knowledge of Buddhism imagine that the aim in Buddhism is the worship of a creator, as in the revealed religions. The truth, however, is very different. Buddhism is a teaching which totally ignores the existence of God. For that reason, Buddhism is regarded as an atheist religion. One of the main reasons for this is the narrow-mindedness of Buddhism. Buddhists build their lives on suppressing human wishes and desires, and on performing various rituals. They never consider the question of how the universe, living things, and human beings came into existence. No Buddhist writings have ever even touched on these matters. Buddhists are therefore unaware of the existence and infinite might of the Almighty God, creator of the universe and all living things. As well as being atheist, Buddhism is also a pagan religion. In other words, it worships idols. The idol in question being Buddha himself. The process of turning Buddha into an ideal began immediately after his death. Buddhist priests set about making him divine. They adorned the places they lived in with great statues of the Buddha, and then superstitiously worshipped these idols they had made with their own hands. They even built temples in which the Buddha's eyes were depicted. They thus believed that the Buddha could see everywhere and constantly watch people. Buddhism, an atheist religion, is unaware of the truths of the teaching of revealed religions such as Islam, Christianity, and Judaism. The most important characteristic of revealed religions is that they regard God as the one and only. In the Quran, God reveals that your God is one God, so submit to Him. Buddhists, however, deny God and irrationally make an idol out of Buddha, a helpless and mortal human being, just like themselves. In other words, they ascribe partners to God. In hundreds of places in the Quran, God reminds us that this association is a very serious sin. God has revealed that He will never forgive those who ascribe partners to Him in one verse. God does not forgive anything being associated with Him, but He forgives whoever He wills for anything other than that. Anyone who associates something with God has committed a terrible crime. Many people believe that Buddhism is a comforting, peace-giving religion. They even imagine that it represents a solution to many problems. This, however, is a great error. Because that which Buddhism regards as a virtue consists of suffering. For that reason, this religion pushes people towards a life full of suffering and poverty. Eating the best foods and being clean and comfortable are forbidden in Buddhism. For Buddhist monks and nuns, life is full of all kinds of difficulties. they are forbidden to work. They feed themselves by going from door to door and begging among the people. For this reason, Buddhist priests are even called bhikkhus, which means beggars, by the people. This is a most humiliating position. Buddhist priests are forbidden to marry or have any kind of family life. They may own only one robe. They eat only one meal a day. And they must finish this before noon. This meal generally consists of bread and rice flavored with spices. It is forbidden to eat such things as meat or fruit. In short, Buddhist strictures are a form of self-torture. Islam, on the other hand, wishes people to take advantage of the good things of the world and forbids them to inflict suffering on themselves. Islam offers a peaceful life aimed at winning the good pleasure of God. People who live by the moral values of the Quran are clean, take pleasure from life, and are always animated, joyful, and happy. This is what God reveals concerning those who, like Buddhists, inflict suffering on themselves. God does not wrong people in any way. Rather, it is people who wrong themselves. Tibet. A land where Buddhism rules. There are many temples here. They are all decorated with gold and precious stones and possess an extravagant appearance. This is supposedly a sign of the respect felt for Buddha. This display in wealth, however, is in sharp contrast to the poverty of the people. Laos, Nepal, India. Buddhism is also widespread in these countries, and the same stark contrast can also be seen in them. Magnificent, wealthy temples and poverty-ridden peoples. In short, Buddhism brings with it injustice rather than social justice, poverty rather than well-being. One of the most striking aspects of Buddhism is its strange superstition-filled rituals. The famous Samye Monastery in Tibet. A ceremony is taking place here. Buddhist priests are playing the radong, a trumpet 4.5 meters in length. This instrument occupies an important place in Buddhist ritual. The Jokhang Temple. People are performing a Buddhist ritual. Bowing down before a statue of the Buddha, they fulfill the obligations of their twisted pagan religion. Buddhists in this temple in Kathmandu blindly continue the traditions handed down from their forefathers, never questioning them in any way. They spend their days praying around the walls of the temple and turning prayer wheels. There are hundreds of flags outside Buddhist temples. These are prayer flags. According to Buddhist superstitious beliefs, the prayers written on these flags are cast around by the wind. Buddhists thus imagine that they have done something meritorious. This, like other Buddhist beliefs, is a superstitious myth. Because Buddhists, who deny the existence of God, cannot even say who they are praying to. Relics of the Buddha and leading Buddhist priests are also kept in these temples. Buddhists entering their temples worship the statues of the Buddha. They offer them flowers and incense. Buddhists regard all these rituals as a way to salvation. But they are gravely mistaken. Because the statues of the Buddha, to which they burn incense and make wishes, can neither see nor hear them. The warnings that the prophets issued to pagans in the past also apply, therefore, to present-day Buddhists. When he, Ibrahim, said to his father and his people, "What are these statues you are clinging to?" They said, "We found our fathers worshipping them." He said, "You and your fathers are clearly misguided." If Buddhists, who blindly carry on the traditions of their forefathers, were to think, they would see what a terrible mistake they are making. The Buddha they worship is helpless and mortal, just like all human beings. In the same way that he created everything and everyone in the universe, God also created Buddha. The only entity worthy of being served is the Almighty God. Concerning those people who fail to realize this truth and worship objects, God asks, "Do they make things into partner gods which cannot create anything and are themselves created, which are not capable of helping them and cannot even help themselves?" Buddha's teaching, which rejects the life of the hereafter, is in grave error regarding life after death. Unfillable gaps thus arise in Buddhists' internal lives and deep wounds in their minds. Buddhist belief on this subject rests on the twin superstitions of reincarnation and karma. According to the belief in reincarnation, they are reborn in different bodies after death. In other words, a person returns to earth after he has died. According to the belief in karma, a person will inevitably be rewarded in his next life for all the things he does in the course of this one. To such an extent, in fact, that a bad person can even come back as a plant or an animal. If so, who judges a person's former life and sends him back into the world in a new body? How, according to this belief which denies the existence of God, does the process of karma work? Buddhists are unable to offer any rational reply to these questions. Because there is nothing rational about their religion. Even if the philosophy of karma may appear at first sight to gain people some positive moral virtues, it in fact leads them to gravely mistaken ideas. According to this belief, people's helplessness, sicknesses, and weaknesses stem from moral impurities and are supposedly a punishment for their deeds in a previous life. For example, the reason why someone is poor or handicapped is his behavior in a previous life. All the bad things that person did in his previous life come back as poverty in this one. In other words, it is well deserved. In Islam, however, people's weaknesses or problems are no crime. They are merely a test. And others are charged with helping such needy people. For this reason, Islam has a very strong sense of social justice. This attitude can also be found in Christianity and Judaism, which come from the same divine source. The belief in karma, on the other hand, which can be found in other Far Eastern religions as well as Buddhism, demolishes the idea of social justice and leads to oppressed people being oppressed still further. The unjust caste system in India, which has been practiced for hundreds of years and divides society into groups, found its philosophical basis in the myth of karma. According to Islam, reincarnation is also a great myth. According to the Quran, there is a life in this world and an eternal life in the hereafter. It is impossible to come to earth more than once. In one verse, we are told the following about death and resurrection. How can you reject God, when you were dead, and then he gave you life. Then he will make you die, and then give you life again. Then you will be returned to him. Every human being is dead to begin with. In other words, the basis of human creation is inanimate substances such as earth and water. God later gives life to this inanimate mass. At a specific time after the individual has been brought to life, life comes to an end, and he dies. This is the end of his life. He returns to the earth and decays back into the soil. That is the second time a human being enters the state of death. Finally, he will be resurrected in the hereafter and give account for everything he did in this world. In the Quran, God says that after a human being has come into this world, he will experience only one death. They will not taste any death there, except for the first one. He will safeguard them from the punishment of the blazing fire, a favor from your Lord. That is the great victory. The Western world began being interested in Buddhism in the 19th century. By the second half of the 20th century, Buddhism had become really fashionable. The pop culture of the 1960s in particular supported the religion and made it famous. Western youth and some intellectuals during those years abandoned traditional Christian belief and began a new search. They turned to the religions of the Far East. George Harrison, a member of the famous band The Beatles, turned to Hinduism, another pagan belief. In the wake of that, millions of Beatle fans also began taking an interest in that teaching. John Lennon used Buddhist mantras in his song, Across the Universe. During those years, Buddhist melodies, clothing, and pronouncements became the fashion. Many young people felt an interest in Buddhism, out of mere imitation, without ever questioning its mythical teachings. Buddhists' unusual clothing, haircuts, and rituals, which passed the bounds of logic and caused people trouble and difficulties for nothing, became the fashion amongst attention seekers. Over the ensuing years, Buddhism was imposed on Western society through popular cultural expressions. In this process, Hollywood took the lead. However, that same Hollywood approached reveal religions in quite the opposite manner. Most Hollywood films espoused beliefs which violated Christian belief and morality. Systematic messages were given out to reinforce anti-religious theories. The The theory of evolution was powerfully imposed on viewers of films with a scientific content. For example, the tradition of anti-religious Darwinist propaganda began with the film Inherit the Wind, which dealt with the famous Scopes trial of a Darwinist teacher in 1925. Hollywood's attitude of opposition to revealed religions was the exact opposite of its attitude towards Buddhism. Buddhism was portrayed in a great many films as a humane religion, attractive and full of peace. One of these films was 7 Years in Tibet, starring Brad Pitt. Kundun, directed by Martin Scorsese, and dealing with the life of the Dalai Lama, the chief Buddhist priest, was propaganda aimed at Buddhist communities. Little Buddha, by the famous director Bernardo Bertolucci, on the one hand summarized the life of Siddhartha Gautama, and on the other hand told of three young children being the soul of the Buddha. What is more, one of these children was Western. The private lives of actors and actresses also played a major role in this propaganda. One of these was the famous actor Steven Seagal. The supreme head of the Nyingma school of Tibetan Buddhism declared Steven Seagal to be the reincarnation of a 15th century Lama. The famous actor Richard Gere, in addition to writing books promoting Buddhism, founded the Tibet House in New York with Richard Thurman, father of actress Uma Thurman. This Buddhist propaganda, which surrounds the Western world and has even been reflected to some extent in some Muslim countries, is no coincidence. Buddhism is being deliberately encouraged. That is because the social forces which are encouraging Buddhism find this twisted religion very compatible with another teaching, which constitutes the basis of their own worldview. Buddhists believe in a constant process of change in nature. According to the doctrine of karma, a fish could come back as a mammal in a later life, and a human being could come back as an insect. In other words, it envisages a transmigration of souls between species and between human beings and animals. Close inspection will show that this error is closely compatible with another contemporary error: Darwin's theory of evolution. One Buddhist researcher has described as follows the relation between Buddhism and evolution. Buddhism is quite happy with the theory of evolution. In fact, Buddhist philosophy actually requires evolution to take place. All things are seen as being transient, constantly becoming, existing for a while and then fading. The idea of unchanging species would not be compatible with Buddhist ontology. For this reason, Darwinists have felt sympathetic towards Buddhism and promoted it ever since the 19th century. The first person to give voice to this admiration was Thomas Huxley, Darwin's strongest supporter. Huxley was an admirer of Buddhism, because just like Darwinism, Buddhism rejected the idea of a creator. In Huxley's view, therefore, it was most compatible with Western civilization. He wrote these words on the subject. Buddhism is a system which knows no God in the Western sense, which denies a soul to man, which counts the belief in immortality a blunder and the hope of it a sin, which refuses any efficacy to prayer and sacrifice, which bids men look to nothing but their own efforts for salvation. Certain other thinkers who sought to impose materialist philosophy and atheism on European societies followed Huxley's path and took an interest in Buddhism. One of these was the German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche, an atheist who harbored a deep hatred of revealed religions. The sympathy felt for Buddhism by such materialists as Huxley and Nietzsche shows the purpose underlying the present-day Buddhist propaganda. Materialists portray Buddhism as a vehicle by which to add some spiritual values, albeit artificial ones, to the non-believing model of society they wish to establish. Their aim is to prevent the rise of the revealed religions by means of alternative false ones. All Far Eastern religions are superstitious beliefs with no basis in God's revelation. People who become caught up in such superstitious beliefs should consider the verses of God, our true Creator, and they should walk on the path of God as commanded in the Quran. Alongside all the erroneous beliefs we have been looking at, there are some positive moral principles in Buddhism. That is one of the reasons for this religion's spread in the West. For instance, Buddhism forbids theft. It encourages people to help one another. All of this suggests that Buddhism possibly began as a religion founded on God's revelation, only to become corrupted over the course of time. In the Quran, God tells us that He sent messengers to every nation to deliver His warnings. We have sent you with the truth, bringing good news and giving warning. There is no community to which a warner has not come. This verse shows us that God could certainly have sent a messenger to the Hindus. That warner might perhaps have been Siddhartha Gautama, known as the founder of Buddhism. After him, however, people may have distorted this religion. and Buddhism lost its original features. Assimilating various local myths, it turned into a superstitious religion. Even if Buddhism genuinely comes from a divine origin, it has by now entirely departed from it. It has been smothered by superstitious beliefs and rituals. And it is now impossible for it to lead people to the true path. Buddhism, an atheist teaching which denies the existence of God, a pagan religion, a fanatical tradition which envisages people inflicting suffering on themselves. In this film, we have looked at the way that Buddhism, which some people regard with great longing, harbors very erroneous beliefs and practices. We have seen how the myths of reincarnation and karma mislead people. The greatest of this religion's errors is the way that it is based not on knowledge from God, but rather on various traditions and philosophies created by human beings over the course of time, and regards these as sacred. Buddhists and those who feel sympathetic towards this religion should consider these truths in detail. And at once liberate themselves from this superstitious belief. Because people who accept teachings other than those of the religion revealed by God are referred to in the Quran thus: what these people are doing is destined for destruction. What they are doing is purposeless. The path that will lead people to the truth, happiness, and peace is that revealed by God, in other words, the religion of Islam. Islam brings people reason, civilization, science, art, and joy. It illuminates their souls and frees them from darkness and despair. Indeed, thanks to this, nations which have been honored by Islam and sincerely lived according to that religion established one of the greatest civilizations in the history of the world and led the world in all fields. That is because Islam is the way revealed by God. The only means of salvation until the day of judgment lies in abiding by that path. As God informs us in the Quran, "This is my path, and it is straight, so follow it. Do not follow other ways, or you will become cut off from His way. That is what He instructs you to do, so that hopefully you may do your duty."